Hello, friends of Zoo Miami and especially, friends of landscaping. Today we'll explore an example of a water garden that, being in South Florida, has to pay tribute to our best-known natural park, the Everglades, a humongous extension of 7,800 square miles that in the rainy season forms a slow-moving river 60 miles wide and over 100 miles long, flowing southward towards the ocean. The first thing we see when we pass the turnstiles is a big map of Zoo Miami. Since it's not easy to figure out what is the scale, you don't fathom the actual dimensions of hundreds of acres and a more than 4 miles long path. People for whom this is not the first visit prefer to rent a cycle, collective, or a scooter, individual, unless you really want to walk. We are not going to walk much since we'll explore today the immediate area after the map. To the right, there are some utilities areas, offices, restrooms and cycles renting, so that we'll keep left of the path. A big sign of Zoo Miami welcomes us surrounded by some expendable pots that are replaced frequently. I wonder why Zoo Miami doesn't make once for all a linear planter making the colorful hedge more permanent, but for sure they will know better. To the left, before the reaching sign, there is a short alley in which the most interesting part is a group formed by clusters of ornamental grass and Vitia palm trees, a genus of the Arcas family. Three Geiger trees with orange flowers complete the setting. Across the alley, a well-developed star jasmine in the corner of the first building. At the end of the alley we find the fishtail palm tree group we were talking about when we discovered it from the flamingos area peering out from behind the terracotta wall. Back to the main path, this time after passing the zoo sign, we'll discover a large pond made to keeping happy here several species of water birds, or more specifically wading aquatic birds since the pond is shallow. Nevertheless, several individuals of two species of pelican live here, although they used to fish in the ocean. They are probably well fed here, so that why adventure going other places? One of the species is the Florida pelican, with a golden head. The other species is the bigger size American pelican, totally white, that during the mating season develops a notorious and weird protuberance on its yellow beak. The rest of the birds are properly wading species, like the large blue heron, the white egret, or the always attractive roseate spoonbill with its unique pink over white feathers that intensifies under the wings. They can be usually seen under the palm trees or wandering about a white bird of paradise, Latin Strelitzia nigulae. The smaller American bittern is a wading bird in the heron family and prefers the second pond, but let's back to the first because what we are interested in is the landscaping and there is a lot of it to talk about. First thing we notice is that in order to keep an unobstructed view of the pond, the landscaping here consists mostly of medium-sized trees above and annuals and ornamental grass below, along a made-to-measure planter that follows the whole rim of the pond. Some shrubs here and there are frequently trimmed to keep them low. The annuals are flowering all the year round thanks to the benign Florida climate. Mostly native species have been chosen. The Florida sage is originally red, as the scientific name declares, Salvia coccinea, but varieties have been easily developed and here we'll find the most popular three, red, pink and white. They go very well together and allow nice contrast with other annual and shrubs that we'll talk about in a minute. The little individual flowers of the Florida sage look like little hummingbirds hanging in the air in the moment of feeding themselves from a flower. The tea bush, Latin Melocia tomentosa, is a filler plant, unobtrusive, with corrugated silver-green narrow leaves that contrast with the surrounding green shrubs and little flowers of an intense dark pink. As a backdrop, a more familiar native red-tip cocoa plum, Latin Chrysobalanus icaco, with green, glossy leaves that during the growing season that covers almost the whole year displays the red ish tips that give it the name. We'll talk about it later since we'll find it here and there along the path. The firecracker, botanical name Roselia equistiformis, is a perennial and comes very handful because its hair-like leaves mix very well with almost any plant and because it blooms almost all year. A good number of tubular flowers, very appreciated by butterflies and hummingbirds. With its see-through branches, it doesn't look like an hedge, making the group looking light, not heavy. It forms here a kind of bridge between the Jathropa integerrima, the popular in Florida peregrina plant with a unique leaf shape, intense red flowers and golden stamens, and the annuals. The wild coffee, scientific name Psychotria nervosa, another Florida native, is counted among the group that I named cooler plants with just green leaves and white little flowers. Nevertheless, the nerved leaves of this shrub are quite something. The American beauty berry will pass unnoticed until the little white flowers transform into vivid purple clumps of shiny balls. Some fire bushes here and there and the ginger complete the shrubs. Above we'll say the first pink trumpet tree, botanical name Tabuia heterophylla. Or even before we see the tree, we'll notice the fallen pink flowers dispersed on top of the green hedge. We'll see more of them along the zoo's path, as we will also see other variants of the Tabuia genus, like the yellow trumpet. The island in the middle of the first pond is basically solved with a gumbo limbo, scientific name Bursera sumaruba, easy to identify because of its bark, and a group of autograph tree, Latin clusurosia, trimmed as shrubs. This plant is known as autograph tree because autographs and other graffiti can be scratched onto the stout leaves that are long-lasting, thick, leathery, and of a pleasant dark green. We'll talk another day about the native gumbo limbo. Another tree here that eventually will grow to a 50-foot full size is the wild tamarind, scientific name Lysoloma lenticillicum, commonly also known as false tamarind. It is native to Florida and you can find it among the hammocks within Everglades National Park. Its small oval leaflets are ideal to have filtered sunlight on the shrubs below. The white powder puff-like flowers are small and easier to see when they fall to the ground. On the opposite side of growing, you'll spot by the water a lovely ground cover with pink round bulbs and a mysterious name, touch me not, in Latin, Mimosa pudica. It owes its name to the fact that its green leaves move whenever are touched, whether it's a person or insect, drawn together and overlapping one another as they begin to hug the stem of the plant. Several species of ferns grow happily by the water. We have several guava trees. See, strawberry guava are more noticeable for the wood, or rather for the beautifully patterned bark, silky and patched on white and cream hues. The fruits are edible berry clusters that ripen in summer. It rarely grows taller than 12 feet. A still small plumeria tree displays in this variety its beautiful yellow and white flowers that are even more prominent when you see them against the sun and with the blue skies on the background. On some trees here we'll also start to discover the aerial plants. They are not parasitical because they don't feed themselves from the tree that supports them. Unlike ferns, they just grow on top of them, but they derive their moisture and nutrients from the air, rain, water, dust, and debris around them. So that they are called epiphytes. The term comes from the Greek epi, meaning upon, and phyton, meaning plant. If we pay attention to them, we'll discover little species of the bromeliads genus, typically tillandsias, with vivid red bracts on its spears, and the of course favorites of everybody, the orchids. Zoo Miami displays several species of orchid blooming at different months of the year, so that it is usual to be able to enjoy at least one in full bloom. A group of native to Florida spider lilies, Latin Hymenocallis, add a splash of white in the middle of the group. They are a dwarf alternative to the similar but taller Crinum lilies that here would block the view, and for some, nicer than them. Not leaving the rim of the first pond, we'll also see daisy-flowered plants like the Florida tickseed, one of 12 Coreopsis species native to Florida, of which we have several cultivar varieties represented here. Another Florida native is the scarlet milkweed, Latin Asclepias curassivica, much appreciated by the monarch butterfly. Ornamental grass has been used more and more in landscaping projects. Apart from the obvious benefits of its resilience, the hairy blades and the graceful spikes makes it attractive. Walking around the pond, we'll find some clumps of ornamental grass and the autograph tree kept here as a slow bush. At the end of the alley, we'll find a couple of yellow flowering interesting bushes. The small-sized beach buttercup, Lanterna elmifolia, with lovely yellow flowers that appear all year long. It's also easy to grow. The second is the taller yellow bell, Lantacoma stans, a fast-growing evergreen shrub with slender, gray-brown branches and clusters of bright yellow, trumpet-shaped flowers. The iguanas are not in the zoo's list of animals, but they enjoy it nevertheless as uninvited guests all around the place. In spite of its ferocious look, the velociraptor aspect and the spiny back, it's a totally harmless lizard that eat grass. Looking further than the rim, into the pond itself, we'll find a good number of plants that grow directly in the water or flooded areas. The water lilies are the most prominent. The beauty of their flowers and the contrast with the leaves acting as a floating ground makes them attractive always. We have here at least three varieties of them on white and purple. The pond apple, Latin Annona glabra, is common in our Everglades. It's a small-sized discrete tree up to 12 feet that grows sometimes in clumps, directly from the floor of shallow submerged areas and produces a fruit that reminds us of a green apple. Aquatic birds love these trees for perching and, in the proper season, for nesting. The papyrus brings some exoticism to the pond, as a reminiscence of the ancient Egyptian civilization, its pyramids and pharaohs. We'll discover at least two varieties in the pond, one more basic and another one with a hairy umbrella. More in a local dimension, the purple-blue spikes of the native pickerel weed, Pontiverial cordata, rise over an island of glossy green leaves. It grows in shallow water no more than a foot deep. The bald cypress, Taxodium disticum, that we see in the second pond is a curious oddity. To my knowledge, it is the only conifer that is deciduous, meaning that it drops all its leaves in winter and then replaces them in spring. It's also the only conifer and one of the few trees that can grow in swamps. It does that by developing above-ground structures known as knees that supply the needed oxygen. Turning around the first pond, we can see and touch a line of trees of another native species, the sea grape, Latin Coccoloba uvifera. Its grapes are edible when ripe, but almost all of the grape is filled by the seed, so that it's not much appreciated as a fruit tree, but because of its leaves that are green when mature, sometimes coppery when young, leathery, often red-veined at the base, and round to kidney-shaped. A curiosity is that this tree is dioecious, so that male and female flowers are on separate plants. This tree can grow on very salty, sandy soils, next to the ocean. That ends the today's chapter. Next time we'll venture further into the surroundings of the Action Center and Gibbons area. You'll see that there are plenty of flowering bushes and trees, and nice shade areas. See you there.